الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear respected brothers, inshallah, now we will have the last lecture of today and we will continue talking about the rules and the conditions of sujood al-sahwi. Okay? Of course, this was the title I intended to explain to you last week, but I found it's a very good opportunity to talk about salat all, to cover everything about salat, not only sujood al-sahw. So, alhamdulillah, we'll study everything about salat. Some of us, they pray, but they don't know which is pillar, which is wajib, which is sunnah. They don't know. That's they pray. But if I ask you, brother, what about takbiratul ihram? This one, is it wajib or sunnah? Maybe I'm not asking now, but just as example, you will find some people said, I don't know. Some people say, I don't know this wajib or rukn or sunnah or what is this? Okay. So alhamdulillah, I found it's a good opportunity to talk about salat, to cover everything in salat. At the beginning, as usual, I used to remind myself first and my brothers and sisters to purify your niyyah when you attending this kind of ta'aleem. Make your niyyah only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because according to your niyyah, Allah will give you. Allah will give you according to your niyyah. Okay? So always try to purify your heart, purify your niyyah when you attending this kind of teaching and ta'aleem. And as I told you before, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he said, when you are coming for majlis al-ilm, for any gathering for increasing your knowledge about Islam, try to be like the bee. When the bee enters garden, the bee will go to the flowers. Okay? So try to be like the bee, getting the good things. Don't be like pig. Don't be like khinzir. Khinzir, when enters the garden, he will search for rubbish. Even if you put good food in front of him, he will leave it and go to the rubbish. This is the example of a person who attending this kind of ta'aleem and his purpose is to get something wrong according to his thinking. So always try to be like the bee, inshallah. Last week, we talked about the importance of salat in Islam. Salat is the second pillar of Islam. You know all the hadiths, the five pillars of Islam. Number one, shahadati an la ilaha illallah wa anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasul. Number two, salat. Number three, zakat. Number four, sawm, Ramadan. Number five, hajj. These are the five pillars. So salat is the second pillar of Islam. Second pillar of Islam. And I told you last week, all the teaching of Islam came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in land, in earth, in Mecca or Al-Madin by Jibreel alayhi salam. Only one thing in Islam, only one thing in Islam came direct from Allah to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without Jibreel. As-salah. This is the only teaching in Islam came direct from Allah to his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the journey of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Sidrat al-Muntaha. Sidrat al-Muntaha. Sidrat al-Muntaha, this place over the five heavens, the seven heavens, very high level. So when our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was in that place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him gift to his ummah. It was the five times salat. At the beginning, it was 50. Can you imagine to pray every day 50 salat every day? But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reduced it to be five. So you pray five times every day and Allah give you 50 salat, thawab. There are many ahadith about the superiority of salat. And this book which we read it before, Riyadu al-Salihin, if you have this book, just open for salat to see, mashallah, a lot of ahadith about salat. One of them, the hadith of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the example or the likeness of the five times prayers, same as one river in front of your house. If you imagine you are living in one house and in front of you there is one big river, and you are going to the river for washing your body five times every day, taking shower. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, is there any dirty will remain in the body? If you are going five times every day to take washing inside the water, is there any dirt will remain in your body? The Sahaba, they said, no. If a person making five times going to the water of the river five times, nothing will remain. Then he said, this is the example of the five times salat every day. When you are praying five times, inshallah, every day with pure niyyah, inshallah, it will washing your sins. Okay? Washing your sins. The scholars said, which sins which are washing by the five times salat, they said the minor sins, not the major sins. The minor sins only, not the major sins. Major sins needs a special tawbah. Special tawbah. Okay? This only one hadith. There are many, many hadiths. Today, inshallah, we'll talk about the salat itself. Now we pray our salat, and as I asked you before, if I ask you about takbiratul ihram or about ruku', about saying sami' Allahu liman hamida, this will be fard or sunnah or wajib. Many brothers or sisters, they don't know. So today, inshallah, we will study one of this. Today, we will talk about the pillars of salat. أركان الصلاة. The pillars of salat. أركان الصلاة. Okay. The pillars of salat. How many pillars for salat? How many? 13. How many pillars, Ihsan, for salat? Pillars. Rukn. 7. 5. Actually, the pillars of salat are 14. 14 pillars. 14. Okay? 14 pillars for salat. Okay? What is the first one? Wudu this out. Wudu is out of salat. Now we are talking about salat itself, not what is out of salat. Wudu out of salat. Brother said niyya. Brother said niyya. Actually, niyya is not pillar of salat. look, mashallah, you studied very well. Yes. The niyya, the niyya, same as I said to Mu'in now. Okay? Same I said to Mu'in, when he said wudu, I said no, the wudu before salat. I'm talking about salat itself, not about something before salat. Okay? Same niyya. Niyya, they considered it, the scholars considered the niyya is shart. Not rukn, not pillar, shart. Shart means something you are doing before entering the salat, but it's important for your salat to be valid. Understand? For example, the niyyah, I make niyyah after takbirat al-ihram or before takbirat al-ihram? Before takbirat al-ihram, I make niyyah. Okay? So the niyyah is before salat because the salat started when I say Allahu Akbar, takbirat al-ihram. This is the salat start from here. Before that, niyyah is important, but it's before. That's why they don't consider it as a one pillar of salat. They said it's shart. Shart means one important condition for your salat to have a niyyah. And if there is no niyyah, it means the salat invalid. Yes. Can be like this. Yes, preconditions. Okay. So if I want to make salat, I make niyyah. I make niyyah before salat. Okay. How to make niyyah? How to make niyyah? By saying, Nawaitu usalli salat al-dhuhr arba raka'at lillahi ta'ala hadiran. Like some people say like this. Before they pray, they used to say very long sentences. Nawaitu, I my niyya to pray salatu al-dhuhr for rak'ah and it's a time and it's for Allah. This kind of saying of niyya is not correct. التلفظ بنية. When you say the niyya by tongue, this actually is not correct. And I don't want to say bid'ah. It's bid'ah actually. Why? Because the Prophet Muhammad never say The Sahaba, they never said like this. They never say, Nawaitu usalli salat al-dhuhr, salat al-... No, they never say. Number two, daniya, usually daniya in the heart. Daniya in your heart. Okay? So how to make niya for salat? How I make niya for salat? Okay. The niya for your salat will be by two things. Two things. Okay. Number one, to know which salat you are praying. For example, now we came for salatul isha. Iqama. Then we will pray salatul isha. So everyone in his heart know now I am praying salatul isha. So this first thing for your name. The second, to know how many rak'ah. Now I know I am praying salatul isha and this is salatul isha four rak'ahs. This is the niyyah. No need to say by tongue. No need. Brother, he asked me, is there any conditions allowing a person to say niyyah by tongue? Can I say niyyah by tongue under some conditions? Okay. Some scholars of Islam, they allowed a person to say niyyah by tongue, but only in one condition. If he having a strong waswasa. Some people having a'udhu billah waswas. Waswas means, for example, when he go for wudu, you know, after he finish wudu, half of wudu, waswas come to his mind, make him confusing and make wudu again. After making again also, waswas coming and make him again, make wudu again. Also some people having waswas, for example, when he is coming to pray, Allahu Akbar, then he having waswas. I said takbiratul ihram or not. I had niyyah or not. And he has a lot of very strong waswas. They allow for this person, like sick person who having this waswas, is to say by tongue. But for normal people, no. For a normal people, no. Not to say niyyah by tongue. So we said niyyah is what? Shart. We say shart. Shart. For salat, because it's out of salat, before salat. Okay. Now let's talk about the pillars, 14 pillars of salat. Okay. Number one, takbiratul ihram. Takbiratul ihram. Allahu Akbar. How to make takbiratul ihram? Of course, you're facing al-qibla. Takbiratul ihram by raising your hands like this. And this will be to your ears like this one, or to be in the level of your shoulders like this. So there are two ways, to make like this or to make like this. Unfortunately, some people, when they make the takbiratul ihram, they do a mistake. I saw some brothers coming to make, just make like this, make like this, look. Even his hand not reaching to this, he just make like this. This wrong. This is wrong. So takbiratul ihram, pillar of salah, number one. Number two, standing. If a person is normal, not sick. Of course, if a person sick and cannot stand, he can sit down. But we are talking about normal people, healthy people. So standing is one pillar. Okay, standing fard in one pillar. Then الفاتحة, reciting الفاتحة, سورة الفاتحة. سورة الفاتحة is ركن, pillar. Of course, later I will tell you what is the difference between ركن and the others. I will tell you later, إن شاء الله. But now, just remember. استفتح. Yes, yes, سورة الفاتحة. No. Why? Because this dua is sunnah. Brothers, understand. We said pillar, then we have wajib, then we have sunnah. There are three. Pillar, wajib, sunnah. Okay? Everyone having different rules. The dua which you said now, of course, there is sunnah. The sunnah that Allahu Akbar takbiratul ihram, and I say dua. This we say dua al-istiftah. Dua al-istiftah. Dua al-istiftah, there are many duas. Yani you can choose some of them. Like for example, subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, tabarak asmuk, wa ta'ala jadduk, ولا إله غيرك. This one دعاء. Okay. There is another دعاء. اللهم باعد بيني وبين خطاياي كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب. اللهم نقني من خطاياي كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. اللهم اغسلني من خطاياي بالماء والثلج والبرد. This one دعاء. And very very nice. Very beautiful دعاء. اللهم باعد بيني وبين خطاياي كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب. The meaning, يا الله, make me away from my sins same as from east to west. Make my sins very away from me. اللهم نقني من خطاياي كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. يا الله, make me out of my sins same as the white clothes came out from dirt to be cleaned. اللهم اغسلني من خطايا بالماء والثلج والبرد. يا الله, wash or clean me from my sins by water, by ice, and then by barad. Barad, the small ice sometimes coming with rain. This small this is meant to have a full cleansing. Okay, this is the meaning of the dua. This one is sunnah. So we said arkan, pillars, wajib, sunnah. This dua is sunnah. Is not rukn, not wajib. That's why if someone didn't do, it's okay. It's not affecting the salat. But it's better to say, to follow the sunnah, better. But if someone didn't say this dua, his salat is valid. Okay, brother? Okay. So we said until Fatiha. Then, ar-ruku'a. Look, I didn't talk about the surah after Fatiha, because this is sunnah. Now we are only talking about pillars. To make ruku'ah, to make the ruku'ah. How to make ruku'ah? The proper way for ruku'ah. Okay, please, brother. Yes. Yes, yes. Jazakallahu khair. So the proper way for wudu, for ruku' is to catch your knees by your fingers like this. like this one. You see, I am catching like this one. Okay. Okay. And then to make your back straight. Straight. Okay. Some people, when they make ruku' like this. This is wrong. Hmm? You have to make your back straight like this. It's very straight. Okay. Your head also straight, not getting down. So this is the proper way for making ruku'a. Hmm? So this ruku'a is rukn. Number five. The knee strongly. What you mean? I cannot answer. Hold. To be like normal, not so strong. Not to be like normal. Okay, like normal catching. Okay, because actually catching the knees to helping you to be in the proper way of ruku'a. Yes. Help. Yes, making the body having balance. Okay. Then number five, al-raf'a min al-ruku'a means to stand up after ruku'a. Al-raf'a min al-ruku'a. Here also some brothers or sisters make mistake. They don't stand properly after ruku'a. Now I finished my ruku'a. Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. I stand. Okay, like this. Okay. Some brothers or sisters, they say, Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Before standing, they go to sujood. Wallahi, this you can see many people do like this. Before standing, they go to sajda. This actually can make the salat invalid, because this one rukn pillar of salat, to stand in the proper way after ruku'a. And of course, there are sunnah to say du'a. We'll say in the sunnah later. Al-raf' min al-ruku'a. So to just stand up from ruku'a. This number. Number five. Number six is standing properly. Look for standing after ruku' having two pillars, just to stand after ruku', and the second one to stand up properly. It means the brothers who do this mistake by not standing and going to sujood, they are doing very wrong action. Then as sujood, to make sajda, to go to sujood. How to go to sujood? Yes. But I'm talking before. Now you are going to sujood. How to go to sujood? Yes, brother. Yes, inshallah. Yes. Okay. So you go like this. Okay. First your knees, and then your hands, and then your head. If some people sick and cannot go like this, not easy for them. At that time, they can use the hands first. Now cannot go like a problem. So no problem to make like this first. So you go by hand first. If you are sick, all the people, sick people, people who have some problem in their knees, so they can do like this. Okay. When you make sujood, according to the hadith, to make sujood on 8 bones. Eight. Number one, knees. Okay. Number two, okay, fingers like this. Number three, your toes, okay, like this. Number, now we said six, yes. Number seven, your head. Number eight, your nose. Because some brothers during sajda, the head touch, but the nose no. He make the just like this, and his nose not touching. This wrong actually. So this is a proper way for sajda. Yes. No. Full like this. Yes, full. Okay, the full hand touch, not like this. Okay, the full. After that, الرفع من السجود, to stand after not stand, to sit, of course, to sit after sajda. This will be similar to ruku', similar to standing after ruku'. We say standing after ruku' have two pillars, stand itself and then standing properly. Two. Also for sajda having two pillars, to sit and then to sit properly. Because also some brothers, after the, when he make the sajda, he didn't sit down. He just, you know, like this, and then go again to the second sajda. This wrong. You have to sit. You have to sit down on how to sit after between the two sajda. Brother, yes. You can show them. Okay, like this one. Yes. So you are sitting on your left foot, and the right foot is standing. Okay, like brother, he made to you like now. Of course, we say one dua, but it's a sunnah. Minimum to say, not sunnah, actually, this wajib, but we'll talk about it later, inshallah. Then number 10. 10 is at-tuma'nina. Tuma'nina means to do the salat in the, to do salat not in hurry. Yeah. Tranquility. Do it in tuma'nina. In tuma'nina, not to be in hurry. Then number 11, the last tashahud, not the first tashahud, last tashahud. Number 12, sitting for the last tashahud. Number 13, at-taslimatayn. To say, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Uh, in some مذهب for example if it is like صلاة الجنازة they can make one taslima only not two maybe you see someone praying صلاة الجنازة and after صلاة الجنازة السلام عليكم ورحمة الله one time only this allowed no problem okay but for the other salat the two taslima I will ask you one question. Is it allowed when you say assalamu alaikum? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Can we say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Is it okay? Is it okay or not? No. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Actually, وبركاته is not mentioned in the salat of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's why if you not, nobody say وبركاته. Usually people say السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بدعة. Yes. Because it's not mentioned in any hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Okay. Then number 14, the last pillar, number 14 is, yes, at-tartib, we say tartib, to make the salat in order. For example, I start by takbirat al-haram, then ruku', then sujood, make an order. I cannot make one before one. Okay. This also the last pillar for salat. So alhamdulillah, we mentioned the 14 pillars for salat. I know it's not easy to remember all of them now, but brothers who wrote this very good. You wrote and then you study, inshallah, by yourself in your house to know the pillars of salat. Now, inshallah, the time for any questions, inshallah. I don't want to go to wajib and the sunnah because I don't want to confuse you. Now, we concentrate only about the arkan. Yes, brother. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You want to use the mic.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for the lecture, Imam Hussein. I'd like to ask because maybe can you explain more after we say takbiratul ihram, what is the proper position of the hand? Like some like this one or this one, or maybe without this one. And then after pada ruku, you said after ruku, there's a hadith that say that, there's the hadith saying that after ruku, the position of the hand should be to the first position. What is the first position mean? Like this one or this one? And after that, in the final, I mean, before the end of salat, we said assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. In jama'ah, especially, when we, as a ma'mun, when we should say assalamualaikum after the imam said assalamualaikum test, then we say it, or after one, then we can follow. Okay, so
jazakallahu khair. Brother Ihsan, you go further. This, inshallah, I will explain when we talk about the sunnah. Okay? So please be interested, inshallah, to come next time to know the answer. Brother, I will answer the last one only. The last one about the time when we, the ma'moom saying assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah after imam. You are asking about it. I know why you ask like this, because according to Hanafi madhab, the ma'moom going with the imam in his Salat, for example, when the Imam said Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, the Ma'mum not wait until the Imam finish. He say with him Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum with the Imam. This according to the Hanafi madhab, actually. Okay, but is it correct or not? According to Hanafi people, if they do, can be okay. But according to the most correct view, you have to say after the Imam finish. Okay, when after the Imam finish the rukn or the pillar, you start. For example, the Imam said takbiratul ihram. So you wait until the Imam finished and then you make takbiratul ihram. The Imam make ruku', you wait until the Imam already became in ruku' and then you make ruku'. Not to go with him in the same time. Okay, yes. This also, even for Hanafi people, sometimes some of them, they could do mistake. And this mistake could make their salat invalid. Like to say before the Imam. Imam, for example, just say Assalamu Assalam before he said you complete, you completed before him. And this actually making the salat invalid.
So after the Imam said Assalamualaikum twice and yes. Then before.
Yes. Not one by one, by finishing the two. After that you say inshallah. Yes, inshallah. Yes. If you miss what? Very good. Actually, if I miss one pillar of the pillars of Salat, what I have to do? If it is easy to go back to that pillar, I can go back and do the pillar. For example, I made the first sajda, then sitting and stand for the second rak'ah. So I forgot the second sajda. But after I stand, I forgot. So at the time you go back to do the second sajda and after that complete your salat. Okay? If the time is longer, for example, you forgot one sajda and then you remember this sajda maybe after one or two rak'ah. Okay? So at the time, what you have to do is to make one rak'ah again. So you miss sajda, okay? And when you came to the third rak'ah, I forgot one sajda. So at the time, what you are in the third rak'ah, okay? So this third rak'ah will be for you second rak'ah. So it means you will make after that another. You will go to the number four for the normal people, it will be three for you. And then you make one rak'ah more. Understand, brother? You mean you made the mistake behind the Imam? If you miss Surah Al-Fatiha, no problem. Okay? If there's Salat Al-Jama'ah, no problem. Like, for example, as you said, I came and the Imam already in the ruku'. So I will not wait until recite Al-Fatiha. The Imam will already stand up. Okay? Now, it's allowed for me. If the Imam in the ruku', I will catch the ruku'. Okay, inshallah. Yes. In the silent or in the silent one? Yes. If the like this, yeah, for example, now I am praying behind the imam, and in the third rak'ah I start to recite al-Fatiha. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Malik, Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Then the imam said Allahu Akbar for ruku'ah, and I didn't finish Surah al-Fatiha. At that time, follow the imam. Follow the imam. Okay? And the imam responsible for that. Complete. No problem. No problem for you. Because it's not your fault. Not your mistake. Responsible means Allah will judge him for that. Because as an imam, you have to be taking care about the people behind you, praying behind you, to give them time. Time to say tasbih, time to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, time to make sujood properly. But if the imam not giving the chance for the ma'moom to do this, he will be responsible. The ma'moom will be forgiven because he had no choice.
So even if it's unintentional, then it's still be accountable.
From?
If it is an unintentional by imam, it is still accountable.
Unintentional. You yep. mean he did it, but actually that's why brother, to be imam, it's not easy. It's big responsibility to be imam for salat, for example. Why? Because you will be responsible about the people behind you. That's why people escaping, the good people escaping from this, because they worry. Maybe they couldn't do it in the proper way. Yes, inshallah. Any other questions, inshallah? Yes.
There is a question from sister. In Japan, sometimes we pray in public places.
Yes.
Is it allowed for women to do sajadah in public places where there are many people around?
Yes, yes. This is a good question. Is it allowed for a woman to make when in the public place to make sajda in front of the people? Okay, before I answer this one, I give advice first to the sister praying in the public place to try to find one corner, not to be praying, you know, in the middle of the place. For example, now I am in the public place and I want to pray. I will choose man or woman. Yani this for a brother or sister. I have to choose a good place. Let's say, for example, this at one shop and I want to pray. Okay. I will not come in the middle to pray, but I will take one corner which is not disturbing other people and I will pray. Okay. This for man or woman. Now the second point, if a woman doing sajda in front of man, woman doing sajda, is it affected her salat? No, not affecting the validity, valid of salat. The her salat is valid, no problem. Okay. Yes, not affecting her salat at all. Not affecting her salat. But we said the advice is to do it in corner, in a place where it's far from people. But the ruling of this one for a woman making sujood in front of man, because I know some people will say, this salah, her salat is invalid. No, this is wrong. Her salat is valid. Okay, inshallah. Any other question, inshallah?
Sheikh Mohsin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Some Sheikh brother asking, okay, please wait. Some brother asking here. Okay.
Brother Firoz, please.
Yes. Okay. Sheikh Mohsin, Jazakallah khairan. Assalamu alaikum.
Speaker, because I cannot hear.
Sheikh Mohsin, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I want to know ikdam if the jamaah start mamun got one raka one sujud and he catch with imam the second sujud, so he want to pray one raka at the end of the prayer. Sheikh Mohsin, my question is, okay, again, I want to repeat. For example, the imam start the prayer.
Mm-hmm.
So he made first sujood, first raka, or any raka. But the mamur come suddenly and he missed first sujood. But he go with the imam the second sujood. So he need to pray one raka at last.
So the imam already done the first sujood, and but he missed. He only used the second sujood, brother.
Yes. The imam start the prayer, so he make first sujood in raka. The mamur come and he didn't catch the first sujood, but he catch with imam the second sujood. So he need to pray the one raka or because he has one sujood with imam.
So
do you understand, brother?
Understand.
Because before Sheikh Mohsin explained.
I think brother Feiruz is asking, for example, the imam has started the prayer.
Yes.
For the jamaat.
Yes.
And you came and you find the imam in the already done the first sajda.
Oh.
And you came and joined in his second sajda, the first rakat.
Yes.
He's asking now after the imam finishing the prayer,
yes.
Are you going to add more rakat on top of that, or the imam has carried away your first rakat?
If the ma'moom came when the imam in ruku'ah. Okay? The imam in ruku'ah. So the ma'moom catches the ruku'ah. Okay? If the ma'moom catch the ruku'ah, some scholar said with one tasbih to say subhana rabbiya al-azim. Some scholars said just by catching the ruku'ah, even without saying bismillah subhana rabbi al-azim, this will be rak'ah for him. But if, like brother Feiruz said, I came in the sajda at the time, this is not accounted for you, okay? Because you came after ruku'ah. If you came for ruku'ah, alhamdulillah, by catching ruku'ah or by catching one tasbih, according to the differences of the scholars, you are having the one raka'ah. But after that, when the imam said Sami Allahu liman hamida and I came, this raka'ah is not accounted for me. Yes. Now, brother Aslam, you want to ask?
Jazakallahu khairan, Sheikh Mohsin.
Is it okay, brother Feiruz?
Yes. Jazakallahu khairan.
Barakallahu.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum.
Sheikh, you said something about, and you said some bid'ah in salah.
Yes.
So can you kindly tell me what is mubah in salah? What is mubah? Mubah.
What is mubah?
What is mubah? And
so sorry, I cannot. What things are mubah?
Yeah, what is mubah in salah? And what is bid'ah hasana? Because some sheikhs, if you listen to them, they say there's bid'ah hasana I don't know. Maybe in the simplest way, inshallah.
Okay. Actually, about bid'ah, is it some bid'ah hasana, good bid'ah? Actually, no. The bid'ah is not good. And the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in the hadith, كل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Each bid'ah is misguidance, and misguidance leads to Jahannam. So we cannot say good bid'ah. We cannot say good bid'ah. Okay? I know why brother asked this question. I know the brother why he asked this question about good bid'ah. Okay. Because Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, during his khilafat, he started to pray salatu at-tarawih in jama'ah. Okay. Before, at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, they didn't pray tarawih in jama'ah, everyone in individual. Also, when Umar became Khalifa radiallahu anhu, in the first time of his khilafa, he didn't, the people didn't pray tarawih in jama'ah. Then later, Umar radiallahu anhu, he found the people praying individual in the masjid. And you can imagine now, let's say 100 people in one masjid, everyone praying by himself. And of course, the recitation is a little bit loud. So it will confusing someone reciting Al-Baqarah, someone reciting another ayats like this. Okay. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he decided, of course, after consulting with the Sahaba, this is very important, very important. He consulted with the other Sahaba about it. This was the habit of all Khulafa al-Rashideen. They always not taking the decision without discussing. Okay. After he discussed and they said, okay, so he started to make Salatu al-Tarawih in Jama'ah. So in Jama'ah, it was more better because you have only one Imam and this Imam reciting same ayat for all people. So not confusing. After that, Umar radiallahu anhu said, it's a good bid'ah. Good bid'ah. This sentence of Umar, some people misusing it by saying, ah, oh, there is some good bid'ah and some not good bid'ah. But actually, it's wrong. It's wrong. The bid'ah is not acceptable. Umar, why he said good bid'ah? Good bid'ah. Actually, the scholar said it's referring to the language meaning of bid'ah, not the sharia meaning of bid'ah. Because the word bid'ah, it has two meanings. Okay, one from the language and the other one from sharia. Okay, for example, I tell you, Salat, okay? Salat, actually, if we go to the language, Salat means, in the Arabic language, what's the meaning of Salat? Huh? The meaning of Salat in Arabic language, Dua. Dua, okay? So we have meaning of language, dua, meaning of sharia, another. It's a prayer which started with takbir and ended by taslim, and this definition from sharia, not from language. So Umar radiallahu anhu, when he said bid'ah, it was referring to the language meaning, not the sharia meaning. Why? Because Umar radiallahu anhu, he knew more than us and more than anyone that the Prophet Muhammad said, every bid'ah is misguidance. Even he used to say it every Jum'ah. When he used to make khutbah, Jum'ah, the Prophet Muhammad used to repeat this. Kullu bid'atin dalala, kullu محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. He used to say like this always in his خطبة الجمعة. Nobody criticized and said you are repeating. He used to say it every salat, every خطبة الجمعة. So Umar رضي الله عنه, he referred to the language meaning. Means it's something new, but this Salatul Taraweeh, is not bid'ah. Why? Because it's started at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He prayed Salatul Taraweeh in Jama'ah for few nights. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw that many people coming and he was worried. He said, I worry about my ummah. If I continue praying Taraweeh in Jama'ah, it will be hard. And it will be hard for my ummah. Look to the Prophet ﷺ thinking about us. He said, it will be hard for my ummah. That's why he stopped. So Umar radiallahu anhu, when he did that, he has some best from the action of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Later, after Umar, all became, yes, all became, alhamdulillah, following this, no problem, inshallah. Yes. As what you did now. This mubah, for example, someone in Salat, he made like this, for example. This okay, mubah, okay? But not to be many actions in Salat. So today, Aslam, focus about what we studied. What we studied today? The pillars, okay? Focus on the pillars, okay? For today. Next, inshallah, we will talk about wajibat, and then we'll talk about the sunan, and the sunan will be two types of sunan. We'll talk about it, inshallah, later, inshallah. Salat what? Salat al-janaza, yes. No, salat al-janaza, salat. Salat. Yes, it's a salat, but in a different way. But it's a salat, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made it and he named it salat, okay? He named it salatul janazah, okay? He named it salatul janazah. And he taught us salatul janazah without ruku' and without sujood, okay? And what is the ruling of salatul janazah? In Sharia, what is the ruling of salatul janazah? Fard, sunnah, wajib, which one? Fard. بارك الله فيك فرض كفاية فرض كفاية فرض كفاية means if some people did it will be enough for others but if nobody did all the ummah will be punished this فرض كفاية فرض عين means everyone has to do like the five times salat so الحمد لله رب العالمين إن شاء الله بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم رب اجعلنا من الذين تجري من تحتهم الأنهار خالدين في جنات النعيم اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما واجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا منا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم زدنا علما يا رب العالمين اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين اللهم اجعل أعمالنا كلها صالحة ولوجهك خالصة ولا تجعل لأحد فيها شيئا يا رب العالمين وصلى الله تعالى وسلم على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين جزاكم الله خيرا